Welcome to part 3 of the Skeletal Animation tutorial mini-series. In parts 1 and 2, we learned how to load the skeleton information using the Assimp library, and we created a mapping so that each vertex can access the bones that influence it, along with the weights. We verified the implementation using a simple demo that shows the triangles that are influenced by a selected bone. In this video, we're going to study the core transformations of the skeletal animation technique. Remember that in part 1, we talked about how you create the appearance of animation in Blender using a set of keyframes where you adjust the location and orientation of the bones in each keyframe. Now, if this was a job interview and I asked you, well, given the way that Blender works, how would you implement animation in general? Then I guess that off the top of your head, you know, you could say that you can save the position of all the vertices in each frame, and then during runtime simply render a different set of vertices in each frame. Well, I guess this would work, but you can obviously see the downsides of this approach. This will probably blow up your model files, as well as your vertex buffer or buffers. Therefore, the approach taken by the actual algorithm is to save a single set of positions, specifically in bind pose that we talked about in part 1. In addition, we associate a set of transformations with each bone, one transformation for each keyframe. During runtime, we perform a weighted average of all the transformations that affect each vertex. In practice, Assimp actually saves the transformations as separate items, one vector for scaling, another vector for translation, and a quaternion for the rotation. We already know how to create transformation matrices from these guys, so no problem there. We only need to figure out how to apply these matrices on the model because it's not that straightforward. There is an additional complexity from the fact that we want a parent bone to affect a child bone, but not the reverse. So if the finger moves, it doesn't affect the hand. But when the hand moves, obviously the fingers also move. To understand how all this works, we need to introduce a new coordinate system called the bone coordinate system or bone space. The origin of the bone coordinate system is at the base of the bone. The bone itself points along the y-axis, and the x and z-axis are perpendicular to the y-axis and to each other, of course. You can turn on the display of this coordinate system in Blender by selecting the armature in the outlier, going into Object Data Properties tab, and inside Viewport Display, you have a checkbox called Axis. We know that in general, the vertices of a mesh are specified in reference to a local coordinate system. So what is the relationship between the local coordinate system and the bone coordinate system? Well, the bones form a hierarchy, which is a simple graph. There is a root at the top, and every node has zero or more children. Every node except the root has a single parent. When rigging a new model, the artist will designate some bone at the core of the model as the root. The remaining bones will branch out from this root and from each other. In the case of a simple human model, it makes sense to use the spine as the root, and then the immediate children will be the four limbs and the neck. From there, you can continue down to the fingers. The bone space of the root is specified in reference to the local space. So you can think about the local space as a primary coordinate system with the origin at 0, 0, 0, and the axes are as usual 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1. The base of the root bone will be some point in this system, same as the regular vertices, and the root bone axis will be vectors in this system. In the following 2D example, the origin of the bone space of the root is located at 1 on the x and 1 on the y, and the bone space axes are some arbitrary unit vectors. Things become a bit more complex when we move from the root of the hierarchy to its immediate children. The bone space of the children are defined in reference to the root, rather than the local space. Going back to a 2D example, we can see the root of the hierarchy at 1 on the x and 1 on the y, and the base of the child bone is also at 1 on the x and 1 on the y, but in reference to its parent, which is the root. In reference to local space, the child bone is actually located at 2 on the x and 2 on the y. In this example, I made the axis of the two bone spaces aligned with the access of local space to make it easier for me to calculate everything in my head, but obviously it doesn't have to be this way. By defining each bone space as a reference to its parent, we can create a chain of transformations that goes from each bone back to the root of the hierarchy. A change in the transformation of a node will obviously affect all of its descendants, but not its parents. If you need an intuition for how this works, you can take the model of the universe as an example. You can trace the orbit of the moon around the Earth in a coordinate system which is centered on the Earth. The parent of this coordinate system is obviously the one where the Earth orbits around the Sun, so if you want to calculate the location of the moon in reference to the Sun, you need to take its coordinates in the original system and multiply it by transformation from the original system to the coordinate system where the Sun is at the origin. The next step will be to multiply the result with the transformation from the Sun coordinate system to the coordinate system where the Sun orbits around the center of the galaxy or something like that. The final transformation will be from the galaxy coordinate system to the universe coordinate system, and this will give you the coordinates of the moon in the universe. So I'm not sure if professional astronomers will approve this model, but I think that for us it is okay. Going back to the bones, the process in skeletal animation begins by transforming the position of a vertex, which is given, as usual, in local space, while the model is in bind pose, to the coordinate system of a bone that influences it. From there, we transform it to the bone space of the parent, and we continue until we get to the root of the hierarchy. At the end of the process, we are back at local space, which is where the root is defined, and we can continue to world and view space as usual. Now, there is a small twist here with Assimp, known as the global inverse transform, which you may have heard of, and I will talk about it later. Since each vertex is often influenced by more than one bone, we actually need to do a weighted average of the transformations of several bones. Each bone transformation will be calculated in the same way by going back from the bone all the way to the root. In addition to that, we also need to tweak the transformation of each node as time progresses, otherwise there won't be any movement. To actually implement this process, Assimp provides us with two matrices. The first one is called the offset matrix, and it is part of the bone structure, which also contains all the weights for the vertices. This matrix transforms from local space directly into bone space, and it already contains all the transformations that go from the root down to the bone, so you don't need to worry about the hierarchy when you use this matrix. The official documentation says that the offset matrix transforms from mesh space to bone space in bind pose, which is basically saying that if you take a vertex in local space while the model is in bind pose and you multiply it by the offset matrix of a bone, you will get the coordinates of the vertex in reference to that bone. This means that if two bones influence the same vertex, then by multiplying the vertex position by the offset matrix of each bone separately, you will get two different coordinates in reference to the two bone spaces. Of course, you will need to go back from each bone to the root and calculate a final matrix for each bone. If you transform the vertex by the two final matrices, and assuming that both bones are moving, you will get two different positions in local space, which is why we do a weighted average of the two final matrices to get a position somewhere between the two bones. For the next example, I've created the world's simplest skeleton in Blender, with the standard box at the origin, and a single bone which is aligned with the y-axis, which is green. As you can see, the z-axis of the bone points up, which is actually the default in Blender. I exported the model in this setup to keep it simpler, otherwise Blender will add transformations from its own coordinate system to the one that we are using, and it will complicate the analysis. Back to our Assimp sandbox, in the function parSingleBone, I've added a call to print Assimp matrix using the mOffsetMatrix attribute of the bone as a parameter. Print Assimp matrix is defined up here, and it is very simple. It just prints the matrix nicely. Now let's run this on the model singlebone.fbx, which is in the Git repo. We can see that we're getting the identity matrix as the offset matrix. The reason is, of course, that the base of the bone is at the origin of the local space, and the axes of the bone space are aligned with those of local space. So transforming from local space to bone space basically means doing nothing. It's the same system. Let's see another example. I've added a child bone that extends the root bone along the y-axis. We can see in Blender that the root bone is located at the origin and the end of the bone is at 1 unit on the y. The child bone starts in the same location and ends at 2 units on the y. If we run this using the sandbox, we can see that the offset matrix of the parent is still the identity matrix, but the offset matrix of the child will translate us 1 unit along the negative y-axis. And this makes sense because this bone space is shifted 1 unit on the positive y. So in order to transform one vertex, for example, this one right here, which in local space is at 2 on the y, to the bone space of the child, we need to subtract 1 unit from the y because the vertex is closer to the base of the bone than to the origin. I have one last example here called two bones translation rotation.fbx, where the child bone has been rotated 45 degrees up, and we can see that the offset matrix of the child is very similar to a matrix that we have developed in the past. So I will leave this up to you as homework to explore. Okay, I hope that everything up until this point made sense. So we can now take a look at the second matrix, which is located at a new section of the SIMP scene. This is the node hierarchy. The node represents an entity in the scene that has a location and orientation relative to a parent. An entity can be meshes, bones, and even cameras and lighting. You can actually design an entire scene in Blender and export it with the camera and lighting and then load it with SIMP. I may do a video about it in the future, but for now, let's just focus on the bones. The node hierarchy starts with a single root node, and each node includes an array of pointers to 0 or more children and an array of pointers to 0 or more meshes. This allows you to have a single mesh in your model file and place it in different locations in the world using multiple nodes. As you can see, it is very simple to create the graph that we talked about earlier using this node structure. There is also a pointer to a single parent and a matrix called M-transformation. The job of this matrix is to transform a vector to the coordinate system of its parent. So this is like the transformation from the coordinate system of the Earth to the coordinate system of the Sun. After we multiply a position vector by the offset matrix, we find ourselves in the coordinate system of the bone. The next step is to find the corresponding node in the graph, apply the M-transformation matrix of this node, and continue all the way to the root by traversing the parent attribute of the node. The bones are mapped to the nodes simply using their names. You search for the name of the bone in the node hierarchy until you find a node with the same name. Let's explore the node hierarchy using our SIMP sandbox. In the parseSeen function, I've added a call to parseHierarchy, which I will now uncomment. This function takes the scene as a parameter and then calls parseNode using the mRootNode attribute of the scene. parseNode prints the number of meshes and children in the node as well as the mTransformation matrix. It then traverses the graph downwards by recursively calling parseNode on each of its children. Okay, so now let's test it on the first example, singleBone.fbx. We can see that the root node is the identity matrix. It has two children, the cube and the armature. The M-transformation matrix of the armature switches the Y and Z axis and also flips the sign of the Y coordinate. Okay, interesting. The armature contains a node called bone, and you can see that the M-transformation matrix here does exactly the reverse. It switches the Y and Z axis again and flips the sign of the Z coordinate, which was previously the Y. Okay, so they are basically canceling each other out. If we multiply these matrices together, we can verify that we're getting the identity matrix. So I actually posted the question about it on the SIMP forum, and I will let you know when I get an answer. There's actually an additional node here called bone end, which I guess is for the tail of the bone, but there isn't an actual bone for this node. So the hierarchy may include nodes that don't have a corresponding bone, but if these nodes have children, then they will have an effect on them, and we will need to take care of that. The transformation of bone end translates one unit on the y-axis, and this makes sense because bone end also defines a coordinate system. So if you multiply the origin of this coordinate system, 0, 0, 0, by this matrix, you will get 0, 1, 0, which is the location of bone end in the coordinate system of bone. So this is a trivial example, but it helps us feel how the hierarchy works. If we run this on a real model, like our good old Bob Lamb Clean, we can see a much more complex hierarchy. We have the root here, then MD5 hierarchy, origin, pubis, pelvis, spine, neck, and head. The transformations here are too complex, so let's just hope it will all work out correctly. The next step is to integrate the two matrices into our skinned mesh class. All this and more will be covered in the next tutorial. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and subscribe. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next tutorial on skeletal animation.